This is lecture number 16, part 5, or last part of carbohydrate digestion, absorption and metabolism in ruminant animals. In this lecture, we will discuss about gas production and gluconeogenesis in ruminant animals. We have discussed already about volatile fatty acid metabolism, and we have discussed about the ratios of different VFAs production and what are the factors which are responsible for changing the molar ratios of different volatile fatty acids. And during the metabolism, we discussed that acetate is a major precursor for the synthesis of fat through this acetyl-CoA. And similarly, this butyrate is also converted into ketone bodies or utilized for the synthesis of lipids once it is converted into acetyl-CoA. And this acetyl-CoA, either it can be utilized for the synthesis of lipid or it can be utilized for the synthesis of energy compounds when it enter into the citric acid cycle. And if we look at this propanic acid, so that is converted into succinyl-CoA, and it follows this pathway for the production of the glucose. So this is basically gluconeogenesis that we will discuss today. That's the synthesis of glucose from non-carbohydrate compounds. There is always a production of gases when there is a production of volatile fatty acid. So little bit about these gas production in the rumen. Usually gas production in the rumen is most rapid and immediate after a meal, and it may go up to 30 liter per hour. So that depend upon the type of stuff which we are feeding to the animal. If we are feeding more roughages to the animal, then there is a more production of gases. These carbon dioxide and methane are the major gases which are produced as a result of ruminal fermentation. If you remember the previous lectures, when we feed roughage or forage to the animal, there's a production of acetate and butyrate rather than more production of the propionate. So when there is more production of acetate, ultimately there is a more production of carbon dioxide. But when there is a production of propionic acid, which is usually due to feeding of grains, the starchy diet, there is no production of gas. No such gas is produced as a result of that fermentation when propionic acid is produced. If we look at the composition of ruminal gases, so about 40% is the carbon dioxide and 30 to 40% is the methane, and 5% is hydrogen together with a very small amount of oxygen and nitrogen. Sometimes this oxygen and nitrogen is only coming from the ingested air. So it means the major contribution or the major gases which are produced, they are carbon dioxide and methane, or both of these gases, they are the greenhouse gases. This is a formation of formic acid or formate. So this carbon dioxide is produced partly as a byproduct of fermentation, particularly when pyruvic acid is converted into acetate. There is a formation of formic acid or formate. And the second way or the pathway for the production of this carbon dioxide gas is by the reaction of organic acids with the salivary bicarbonate. Here is a reaction how this formic acid is converted into methane in the rumen. This is the formate or formic acid. It is converted into carbon dioxide and hydrogen as a first step. Because there is anaerobic condition, hydrogen do not have sink. So it combines with the carbon molecule and it makes a methane gas. So this is how these two gases, they are formed in the rumen. The synthesis of methane or methanogenesis is a complicated process, and it involves folic acid and vitamin B12. So how much quantity of methane is formed? There is an estimate that every 100 gram of carbohydrate digested in the rumen result in the production of 4.5 gram of methane gas. And if we look at the losses due to this methane gas, so ruminant animals, they lose about 7% of their food energy as a methane, because carbon dioxide and methane have nothing to do with the nutrition of the body. Once they are formed, they have to be belched out from the rumen of the animal. So it means the production of these gases is an energy-based process. And there is an inverse relationship between propanoid and methane production. The reason for this relationship is that carbon dioxide and hydrogen are the byproduct of the conversion of glucose to acetate and butyrate. In contrast, when both the succinate and acrylate pathway are used for the synthesis of propanic acid, then all carbon and hydrogen atoms present in the glucose, they are utilized for the synthesis of two propanoate molecules. If you remember the previous equations, glucose is composed of six carbons. So when it is broken down into propanoate, so propanoate is a three-carbon molecule. It means two propanoate synthesis will occur from a glucose molecule. But when glucose molecule is converted into acetate or butyrate, butyrate is a four-carbon. So two carbons are left there for the production of gas. Similarly, when there is an acetate, again, there is the formation of formate, and that results in the production of carbon dioxide and methane gas. Then comes the gluconeogenesis. So before going into detail of gluconeogenesis, I would like to discuss about the glucose requirements, particularly in case of ruminant animals. When we compare ruminant animals with monogastric species, the blood sugar or blood glucose level in ruminant animal is between 40 to 60 milligrams per deciliter. This glucose level is lower as compared to the monogastric species. Like if we talk about the human being, there is a 80 to 120 milligram per deciliter. The second is there is a less fluctuation in the blood glucose level of ruminant animal. The reason being, these animals, they eat more constantly than the monogastric species. They eat and then they go for regurgitation of the material. It means there is a constant eating. Ultimately, there is a constant VFS production and there is a continuous flow of the digester from the rumen. And when VFS production is continuous, VFS are the precursor for gluconeogenesis, particularly this propanoate. So there is a continuous glucose formation from non-carbohydrate substances. So as a definition, gluconeogenesis is the synthesis of glucose from non-carbohydrate precursors. So these precursors may be propanoate, glucogenic amino acids, glycerol, and lactic acid or lactate. However, small amount of glucose can also be made from odd chain fatty acids. Usually fatty acids are even chain, but some of the fatty acids are formed as a result of ruminal fermentation, which are odd in number. So all the substrates used for gluconeogenesis, they enter the citric acid cycle and they yield malate, then phosphoenol pyruvate, and finally the glucose. The major difference between ruminant and non-ruminant animal in terms of gluconeogenesis is the rate of gluconeogenesis. The gluconeogenesis rate is higher after feeding in case of ruminant animals, whereas in case of non-ruminant animals or monogastric species, the rate of gluconeogenesis is minimum after eating. So this is just opposite to that of the ruminant animal. So why gluconeogenesis increases after feeding and it decreases during fasting in case of ruminant animals? The reason being, the precursor for glucose synthesis, they are available after meal. because the end product of carbohydrate metabolism is not the glucose in case of ruminant animals. Those are the VFAs that are utilized for the synthesis of glucose. Whereas in case of monogastric species, the end product of carbohydrate digestion is the glucose. So that's why gluconeogenesis is not at a higher rate after the meal. But during fasting period, the gluconeogenesis is at a higher rate in monogastric species. Why gluconeogenesis? The reason being, some of the body tissues or organ, they rely on a continuous supply of glucose for their functioning, for their viability, like nervous tissues, erythrocytes, muscles, adipose, mammary glands, and fetus, all these require glucose as a source of energy. They do not utilize or they do not have the pathways for the synthesis of glucose. So that's why a direct glucose supply is required for their functioning. Nervous tissue, they use 600 gram glucose per day. However, in case of ruminant animals, they have the advantage over the non-ruminant animals. They can tolerate hypoglycemia. But in case of monogastric species, under the hypoglycemic condition, the migraine or headache are the common signs. But ruminant animals, they can tolerate a very low glucose level, that is as low as 18 milligram glucose per deciliter of blood for even 6 hours without any negative effect. How they can tolerate? The reason is the brain and spinal cord that tend to be lower as a percentage of body weight in ruminants as compared to the other animals. Now, in case of monogastric species, the brain and spinal cord, their percentage is higher as compared to the ruminant animal on the basis of per unit body weight of the animal. When we talk about the muscles, they again require glucose for the production of glycogen, although a small quantity of glucose is oxidized directly. Ruminant muscle contains less glycogen than do those of the other species that reflect a lower amount of glucose available at the tissue level. In the adipose tissues, glucose is required as a source of glyceride or glycerol. So this glycerol then combined with the fatty acid to make a lipid molecule. For the synthesis of this glycerol, the glucose is required. And it is probably play an important role in maintaining the level of intermediate of citric acid cycle in many tissues. So during the fat metabolism, glucose is of utmost importance because it provides NADPH, which is formed by glucose oxidation by a hexose monophosphate pathway. NADPH is required as a reducing agent at a different step during the synthesis of long chain fatty acids. Fetal requirements of glucose. Sheep fetal glucose metabolism is about 40 to 70% of the total glucose metabolized in a sheep. And from milk synthesis point of view, milk contains 5% lactose. So if an animal is producing 40 liter of milk on daily basis, so that animal required 2 kg glucose per day. And if we look at a high producer animals, the lactose production can account for 60 to 85% of the total body metabolism. This is a very high figure that reflects the importance of propionate production or the production of glucose through gluconeogenesis. Ruminant animals, they utilize acetate instead of glucose as a major substrate for energy storage and oxidation. They rely on gluconeogenesis for glucose during both fed and fasted state. The rate of gluconeogenesis in ruminant animal is higher, at the highest level shortly after a meal, when gluconeogenic substrates or precursors they are available in a large amount. Quantitatively, if we look at how much quantity of a particular precursor is utilized for the synthesis of this glucose, the propionate and glucogenic amino acids are the major precursors, and they makes a net contribution to glucose synthesis. Acetate as a source of energy. Acetic acid is the only BFAs present in the peripheral blood in significant amount. If you remember, the acetic acid escape liver oxidation. More than 80% of the acetate is available in the peripheral blood. So it is converted into acetyl coenzyme A through this acetyl coenzyme A synthetase in a cytosol. The acetyl coenzyme A is unable to cross the mitochondrial wall and has to be complex with carnitine to achieve this. So in the mitochondrial matrix complex, it is broken down and it releases acetyl coenzyme A, which is then enter into the TCA cycle and is oxidized and yield 12 moles of ATP per mole of acetate. So two high energy phosphate bonds, they are used during the initial synthetase mediated reaction. So there is a net yield of 10 moles of ATP per mole of acetate. So it's a summary of the amount of energy produced or the number of ATPs formed. There's the 12 ATPs. And if we look at the propionic acid, there's the propionate. So during the gluconeogenesis, a propionate can follow two pathways. During the first pathway, it yield 34 ATPs, whereas it yield 18 moles of ATP for the second pathway. During the first pathway, the phosphoenol pyruvate is converted into glucose. And then glucose is utilized through this glycolytic and TCA cycle. Whereas in the other pathway, phosphoenol pyruvate is not converted into glucose, rather it converted into acetyl CoA. Then acetyl CoA yield this carbon dioxide and water and it yield energy. In the first pathway, the energy production is more as compared to the second part. And when we talk about the butyrate, then there is a production of 25 moles of ATP. The butyrate is converted into beta hydroxybutyrate, then into acetyl CoA, then acetyl CoA enter into the citric acid cycle and give energy. So total 25 moles of ATP from 1 mole of butyrate. When we talk about the fat, again, there are the two pathways. Through the first pathway, there is 21 moles, and through the second pathway, there are 22 moles. In the first pathway, the glycerol is 2 moles of glycerol is converted into the glucose, and then glucose through TCA cycle, glycolytic or then TCA cycle. Whereas in the second pathway, the glycerol is converted into dihydroxyacetone phosphate. Dihydroxyacetone phosphate is then converted into pyruvate, and then pyruvate enters the TCA cycle, and it gives 22 ATP. Here is an example of beta oxidation of palmitic acid or palmityl CoA. It gives 129 moles of ATP. So in the previous slides, we discussed about BFAs and fat as a source of energy, and next is the protein as a source of energy. Protein is a very costly item, and we do not prefer its utilization for the synthesis of glucose, but when there is hypoglycemia, animal will utilize these amino acids for the synthesis of glucose because they don't we don't left with any other option if energy is deficient or glucose is at a low level. So in that case, amino acids, they are utilized as a source of energy, or they are converted into glucose through gluconeogenesis. But under the normal condition, only excess amino acids, they are catabolized or they are utilized as a source of energy. Except for lysine, leucine, and taurine, the rest of the amino acids, they are utilized. And on a molar basis, alanine, glutamine, glycine, and serine, they account for about 70% of the total amino acids removed by the liver. Alanine and glutamine are the most glucogenic And these two amino acids, they account for 40 to 60% of the glucose formed from the amino acids in case of sheep. So here is an example. If we assume that 55 gram of glucose can be synthesized from 100 gram of protein, then 70% of glucose production for a well-fed non-pregnant sheep could come from amino acids. When glucose synthesized in both liver and kidney, like these amino acids, they are utilized for the synthesis of glucose both in liver and kidney. Then in a ruminant animals, which are fed at maintenance, they derived at least 50% of their glucose from amino acids. And the maximum contribution of amino acid to glucose requirement is about 36%. So they can contribute up to 36% of the glucose requirements. And out of that, 32% will come from the liver and 4% from the kidney. So this is a cycle, and this is from Thomas Hare Education site. If you look at this, this is the pyruvate, which we mostly consider that the intermediate, either for this energy production cycle through acetyl-CoA, it can enter into the citric acid cycle. Or this is a precursor for the conversion into glucose, or the precursor for the utilization of gluconeogenesis. So lactate, glycerol, and carbon skeleton from glucogenic amino acids. Because glucogenic amino acids, after deamination, they are converted into carbon skeleton. So they are used to form the pyruvate. So either lactate, glycerol, or amino acid, glucogenic amino acid skeleton, carbon skeleton, they are all converted into pyruvate. So this pyruvate can enter into this cycle. You might ask, okay, why? That is going towards this side, why not towards this side? If you look at this, pyruvate is derived from the citric acid cycle. Rather than forming acetyl-CoA, pyruvate is converted to oxaloacetate. The reason being, this acetyl-CoA, if you remember, there is an oxaloacetate. That oxaloacetate is bind with the acetyl-CoA that makes a citric acid. So when oxaloacetate is not there, because the body is in glucose deficiency or hypoglycemic condition. So what will happen, this cycle will not be in a running form. So that's why pyruvate cannot be converted into acetyl-CoA, because if this pyruvate will convert into acetyl-CoA, so that will accumulate over there. That acetyl-CoA will not be utilized. The reason being, the oxaloacetate is not there. So that's why this pyruvate is converted into oxaloacetate. And then again, the oxaloacetate, it cannot enter into this cycle because this acetyl-CoA is not there. So this oxaloacetate is then converted into phosphoenol pyruvate. Oxaloacetate exits the citric acid cycle and is converted to phosphoenol pyruvate, even if it is if some is there. Carbon skeleton from other glucogenic amino acid enter the citric acid cycle, forming the oxaloacetate. So this oxaloacetate through decarboxylation is converted into phosphoenol pyruvate. This phosphoenol pyruvate, two molecules of phosphoenol pyruvate, they are combined to form the glucose. This is a gluconeogenesis. Here's a very detailed description of this gluconeogenesis. If you see this reaction, these are the irreversible reactions. Glucose either converted into glucose 6-phosphate or glucose 6-phosphate either converted into glucose. There is no way like this that glucose can be converted into fructose or fructose can be converted into fructose. The reason being, the enzyme required for this synthesis, these are the rate limiting steps, gluconeogenesis. So here we are, here is the pyruvate. And this is the mitochondria. This is in the cytosol. So this pyruvate is made available from this lactate, as we have discussed already in the previous slide. And then glucogenic amino acids, they are converted into the pyruvate. So Similarly, the lactate is also converted into this pyruvate. So this pyruvate is then enter into the mitochondria, and then it can be converted into acetyl-CoA, and if oxaloacetate is there, so it will follow this path. But under hypoglycemic condition, what happens is pyruvate is converted into oxaloacetate. This oxaloacetate is then converted into phosphoenol pyruvate, and this phosphoenol pyruvate then come into the cytosol, and then it is converted into glucose. The other pathway is this oxaloacetate is converted into this aspartate, and it come out of this cytosol, and finally that is available in the form of oxaloacetate. Similarly, malate also come out of the cycle if the glucogenic precursor like this glutamate, histidine, they are entering into the TCA cycle, propionate or other, they are entering into this TCA cycle at succinyl-CoA. So all that lead to the formation of either malate or oxaloacetate. So malate can also come out of this mitochondria and then it is converted into oxaloacetate, or malate can also be converted into oxaloacetate that then comes out of this cycle. Because these are the gluconeogenic precursors in the mitochondria, so they are converted into their respective molecules and then enter into the TCA cycle, or they join the TCA cycle after conversion into the relevant product of that TCA cycle. So ultimately, the objective is to produce the glucose through this cycle. So these are the key enzymes. Not going into detail of these enzymes, but just for the information, these enzymes, they are required to continue the gluconeogenesis process. Just a brief description of the same: pyruvate in the cytosol enter into the mitochondria, converted into the oxaloacetate, then oxaloacetate into the malate, and then malate comes out of this and converted into the oxaloacetate and phosphoenol. Lactic acid or lactate converted into the pyruvate in the mitochondria, oxaloacetate, and then there is a formation of phosphoenol pyruvate within the mitochondria that comes out of this mitochondria and present in the cytosol. So if you remember this, either the phosphoenol pyruvate or either the oxaloacetate, they are all being converted into the glucose. So if the number of moles of ATPs per mole of nutrient or per 100 gram of the nutrients or heat of combustion, just a comparison, definitely different type of the substrates, they have different moles of ATP production. Not going into the detail or type of the substrate utilization, the reason being, within the body, whatever is present during the hypoglycemic condition, that will be utilized for the production of the glucose. But again, that depend upon the concentration of that type of precursor. And this is the reason when we go for designing a proper feed to the animal, we always take care of the things. No such situation arise in the human environment that can lead to the utilization of costly nutrients for the production of the glucose. So we always prefer to go for those nutrients which are cheaper in price that can be utilized for the production of energy, just to save the production cost or to reduce the production cost.